Ladies, severe aortic stenosis and NYHA class 3, aortic valve area 0.5, mean gradient of 56, peak gradient of 88, normal LV function, concentric LVH, diabetes mellitus type 2, ECG shows sinus rhythm, narrow QRS. Next one. So if you see the CT scan, it is type 0 bicuspid. Next one. And the annulus perimeter is 66 millimeter, diameter are 18 by 22 millimeter, area is 330, and LVOT perimeter is 63. You see a small speck of calcium extending into the LVOT. Now this lady, her body surface area is around 1.8. Next one. These are various measurements where you see that calcium is extending slightly into the LVOT. The ascending aorta is normal dimension, because this is very important. When we do a bicuspid case, you need to focus on the ascending aorta. If there is an aortopathy and patient is inoperable, that is the only indication you would do a TAVI. Otherwise, such patients should undergo Bental. But here you see the ascending aorta is only 30 millimeter or 3 centimeter. So that's the normal size. Next one. And then the measurements at the intercommissural distance is around 23.4. Next one. So I'll brief few more findings. The coronary heights are 14 and 16 millimeter, and the other parameters are within normal limits. There is no red flag. Both the femoral arteries. Go to the next slide. Yeah. So these are a few additional CT scan pictures where you also find out the implanter's angle in a bicuspid valve. This is a true bicuspid where there are only two cusps are seen. The angle is LAO 28. And these are the femoral dimensions. The right and the left, both are minimum is 5.5 and 5 millimeter. That's also one factor which you would consider when you are doing a transfemoral TAVI, because you want to choose a valve which can go from the femoral root. Because if you see all the trials, it is the TF approach which made a difference. And the other important thing is you look at the level of bifurcation. So in the right, it is lower than the left. Next slide. So now go back. See my previous slide, please. Previous slide. Oh, yeah. Just stop there. So this was the whole discussion about what valve to be selected. So if you look at the area, it is 330 millimeter. And if you look at the perimeter, it is 66 millimeter. So as per the area sizing, this will fall into a 20 millimeter balloon expandable valve. For a self-expandable, this will fall into a 26 millimeter evolute R, sizing based on the annulus and sizing based on the intercommissural distance. So I'll leave this for your discussion, Bhupati and sir, that how will you select, which valve would you select in such a patient? Bhupati.
Sir, Ravinder, thank you, Ravinder, for this opportunity. So the femoral anatomy is a non-calcified vessel, 5.5 is good enough for both the valves. Let's go to the aortic anatomy. You go to the aortic anatomy, it's bicuspid. Can you give me the dimension of the annulus, Ravinder? Minimum,
go back,
maximum.
Go back to the presentation. Scene minus. So it is 18 by 22, but I'll show you that slide. Minus, scene minus. Not the scene, slide minus. Previous slide, please. Previous slide. Stop there. Next one. Yeah. So these are the annulus dimensions. Perimeter 66, diameter 18 by 22, area 330, LVOT perimeter 63. Perimeter derived diameter is 20.1, and area derived diameter is also around 20.
Okay, what's the sinus are adequate, Ravinder?
Yes, sinuses are 33 millimeter. Coronary heights are 14 and 16 millimeter.
And your intercommissural diameter is something
like 23. Go to the next slide.
Okay, got it. So the I would say
there's a small calcium in the LVOT also.
Yeah, small calcium. So body surface area of the patient is
1.8.
I would say that is the only reason why I would select a supraannular valve design.
Exactly.
There is no head-to-head comparison between a self-expanding design as compared to balloon expanding in this subset. There are two randomized studies that compared self-expanding versus balloon expanding head-to-head. But they have completely excluded this category of patients who are having bicuspid pathology, especially Sievert's type 0. And the other point that needs to be emphasized in this, what is the age, approximate age of this patient?
So she's 68 year old lady.
Physically, she's physically active.
Yeah, she's physically active. Her STS score is 3.1. She's a low risk and a youngish patient.
Okay. So I would say considering the valve area, I mean the area derived diameter that for that favors Sapien 320. In general, Sapien 320 we don't prefer. We will go for the supraannular design if it comes for Sapien 320, unless the anatomy is not suitable for the supraannular design. For example, if the sinus is quite small. Or if the patient has got extensive CAD where we cannot cannulate the coronaries later for the coronary intervention, I would go with a self-expanding design in this patient. Other aortic anatomical feature, what my teachers here see is that aortic annular calcium at the level of the commissure, if there is going to be for example, in this particular patient, in bicuspid valve, if the raphe has got a calcium, then we actually go with the balloon expanding valve because we don't want to put a valve and then dilate and we don't know what exactly we are going to do during the post-dilatation process. So whenever the raphe has got a calcium, which is significant in nature, we usually prefer a balloon expanding valve going ahead and deploying it at one stretch and then coming out. If the raphe is there and doesn't have any significant calcium, then we can select both the, we can go either with the balloon expanding or with self-expanding valves. In this particular patient, considering a significant body surface area, with the, that favors, I mean, that goes towards Sapien 20 as compared to versus Medtronic 26, I would definitely go for Medtronic 26 valve.
Sir, what do you think?
Well, I think if I have to have a case of a bicuspid valve, first type 0 is the best to have. I would have anticipated a lot more calcium, but fortunately...
Go to the last slide.
Not that much.
Not last, next slide. Yes, sir.
Calcium is one factor in which I might want to upscale the size of the valve a little bit. But here the calcium does extend. The other thing I want to know is what is the length of membranous septum?
So it is 5.2 millimeter. That slide is not there, surprisingly. It is 5.2 millimeter. We have started measuring the membranous septum length in all the patients to reduce the pacemaker. And this is in this patient is 5.2.
Right. So I think anything more than 5 is a reasonable comfort level. If you are the annular alignment, then I think the pacemaker chances can be considerably reduced. I'm not very sure. It's a annular diameter is about
22. Annular mean maximum diameter was 22. So perimeter was 66, sir.
Right. I think then the 26, because you will have to always oversize as when you use a Medtronic or a long frame valve and the self expanding. 26, I think, is an appropriate choice.
Yeah. So I agree with both the experts' opinion. The reason why we have to choose a 26 millimeter valve in this particular patient is because she's kind of youngish for a TAVR population. And then if you put a 20 millimeter valve and patient has a body surface area of 1.8, this patient will have a patient prosthesis mismatch. But on the other hand, if this patient was in her 80s, octogenarian, nanogenarian, probably I would use a 20 Sapien 3 because I don't want any pacemaker, any sort of complication in such patients. I want them to discharge early. We still have to wait for the data that does a high gradient in a TAVR patient at baseline will lead to early degeneration of the valve. But logically, if you look from the surgical data, whenever a small valve is put in a patient and patient has patient process mismatch, there is high chance of early degeneration. Also, if you look at data from the TVT registry about patient process mismatch, it was higher in a balloon expandable valve, especially in the small. And the post-dilatation, if required, will be a 22 millimeter valve. So next one.
Ravinder, what is the LVOT area or perimeter?
63. I mentioned that. That's again very important thing.
Okay.
It's because if your LVOT is too small, it's high chance of complete heart block, high chance of rupture, high chance of valve embolization. But and if your LVOT is too large, then again there's a high chance of paravalvular leak. So what we'll do is, you see here we have a 6 French artery on the left side, 6 French vein on the left side. I'm going to do an ultrasound guided puncture. Can you see the ultrasound? Can we have the ultrasound?
We don't see your video, Ravinder.
Can we have the ultra echo? Can we have the echo? Can you see that?
Yeah.
Yeah. So multiple techniques of doing an access. You can have an ultrasound guided access. You can have a fluoroscopy guided access. You can have a pigtail guided access. But how does ultrasound has helped us is because you can identify a sweet spot on the common femoral artery and make sure there is no calcium on the anterior wall. So how does that spot look to you, Bhupati and sir?
Awesome.
Okay, so we're gonna go at the middle of the probe, and then you see that you do a jig-jag movement and you try to enter the artery. But you know, once in a while, what I have to do is, I would go fluoroscopy if I'm not able to.
Exactly. That is what I was about to say, Ravinder. In case ultrasound we select, we always go and check it in fluoroscopy.
Yes.
Because it's difficult to identify inferior.
But I would still go ahead and take a picture just to make sure, doubly make sure that we are at the right spot. So you can focus on the groin. Here's a micropuncture sheath which is being inserted. Give me contrast. Okay. Show us down, please. Okay. Come, Aryo.
You prepare.
So you see, we have an anterior wall common femoral artery puncture. What do you think about this? And we are below the inferior epigastric artery. Play that picture, please. And freeze.
Yes.
Freeze. Yeah. Forward. So you need to identify the inferior epigastric artery. Play. Okay. Freeze. Bhupati, for the audience, if you could point out and explain the inferior epigastric artery and where we are...
It has to be run a little forward.
Forward. Play that. You freeze at the inferior epigastric artery. I'm going to ask you to freeze. Okay, freeze.
Yeah, freeze. Yeah, this is the site of inferior epigastric artery that demarcates the external iliac artery from the common femoral artery. The loop is the inferior epigastric artery is arises from the external iliac artery in the abdominal component and comes around and wraps around the inferior ligament to enter into the anterior abdominal wall. That is the site. So it is not the origin of the inferior epigastric artery that matters. It is the site at which it loops around that matters. So if you stick in the zone between the ostium of the inferior epigastric artery and the U of inferior epigastric, you are actually using external iliac artery, and it may lead to retroperitoneal hematoma.
So I'm just going to make one more small clarification: is the valve which we are using is PRO, and the reason we are using a PRO is because of that small calcium in that LVOT. And will the chance of PVL and requirement of post dilatation will be less. But as Dr. Bhupati pointed out, sometimes what happens on fluoroscopy, it looks very comfortable that you have punctured the artery, you have obtained good access, but still patient develops retroperitoneal hematoma post procedure, and that is because your puncture is above the inferior epigastric artery. So I think that's a very important point for us to understand. So I'm going to do I've put a nick. Now I'm going to dilate the tract with a forceps, artery forceps, and you need to go all the way till the top of the artery to make sure there is no subcutaneous tissue there. And then give me a 6 French dilator. Can you focus on the ProGlide here? Remove the II, and then I'm going to put a 6 French dilator because the profile of a ProGlide is 6 French. Okay, ProGlide now. So the plan is to put one ProGlide from 3 to 9 o'clock position, and then post procedure we'll put an 8 French angiocene. What we have noticed in this technique is the pinching of the artery is not there compared to 2 ProGlide. Then the success of this combination is more than the success of using 2 ProGlides in my own practice. So for the earlier almost all the cases I was doing two proglides, and we never had a problem, but few patients had a pinching of common femoral artery. So the wire out, so you can see the proglide here. You hold it like a pen, you go inside, you see the side port. The blood should flow, then come out again. Just go in inside the artery, deploy the foot plate, pull back, maintain the pull, fire, hold the hold the proglide, pull out, cut the wire on the blue portion, foot plate down, hold it here please, harvest your sutures, put them on one side, and then next is put the wire. Always use a long wire in this exchanges so that you don't, you know, there is no chance of losing the wire when you're removing the proglide. So it's a good idea to use a long wire. And then we'll put a 9-French sheath. Let's give full dose of heparin, please.
Yep.
So we would like to give heparin in accordance with ACT of 300 as soon as we have our proglides in place.
I wish the people have noticed what Ravinder said. He asked the second operator to hold the proglide when he was trying to harvest the suture. That's very, very important.
Very important.
Step, especially in obese individual, the proglide is such a hydrophilic thing. It may actually come out in an obese individual, and the available length of the proglide inside the artery might be small in an obese individual. So always, while harvesting the suture, ask your second operator to hold the proglide on the thigh, so that it doesn't move.
Upti, any other tricks and tips and tricks you want to give about vascular closure, how you are doing in Mount Sinai? So we're going to put
Ravinder, we are still going with two pre-closers. Since it is a training institute, we always go up and over. Unless there's no absolute calcium in the vessel. And the category of patients, what is being treated here as compared to our population, you know it better than me. Yeah, a lot of calcium, a lot of disease, high vascular, high risk for vascular complications. Then they would have undergone multiple procedures before. So it's a kind of a different anatomy here. So we always go with two pre-closers, and it's not essential. We are trying to go to one pre-close and one angiocele technique, especially if it is going to be a single groin access.
Okay. So I agree with you. The patients in the US is a different population where they have bad peripheral artery.
Body mass index is quite high.
Yeah. And fate, please. So we always use balloon tip pacemaker for our almost all the patients now. Not even for TAVI only, but also for our PCIs also. We would use a balloon tip pacemaker. And so what about MANTA device, Bhupri? Is it there in US?
No, the cost of MANTA is at least 5 to 6 times higher as compared to ProGlide. And one other institute in New York which had experience with MANTA, we got information that it's not as good as ProGlide. The learning curve of MANTA is slow, but vascular problems are quite high as compared to ProGlide. People who are comfortable with ProGlide, it's very, very difficult to go into a different device.
I agree with you. Okay. Inflate, please. Inflate. Partial inflation. So we're going to inflate it partially and we'll do a pacemaker check. So pacemaker is very important, in fact, for all the TAVIs, but all the way more important if you're doing a balloon expandable valve. So we're going to pass on this to our anesthetist. He controls all our pacemakers. And can I have a 5-French pigtail, please?
Ravinder, in your practice, how many cases do you do up and over?
None of these. No case as of now. But what I do is, if there is a hostile groin, before I remove my big sheath, I would keep my dilator on the side. I would keep my dilator and my stiff wire inside the axis. I would just pull back my sheath to the level of external iliac artery. And then I'll take a picture. So if there is no perforation in the common iliac artery, again, I'll pull back my sheath till the level of the common femoral artery, but not all the way out. I'll take one more angiogram. If there's no perforation in the external iliac artery, I would go ahead, leave the wire in place, remove the sheath, cinch my proglide. But before I remove the wire, I'll take one more picture to make sure there is good flow in the superficial femoral artery. Suppose if there is any complication, I would go ahead and advance the same sheath with the dilator and the stiff wire, and then try to solve the problem either by putting a covered stent through the sheath itself, or I haven't come across any requirement of an urgent vascular surgery. But yes, if it is there, at least we have tamponaded the blood vessel by putting the big sheath in. Forward, please.
How about giving protamine at the end of the procedure? Do you practice?
No. So, I haven't, in all my cases, I haven't given protamine yet. The reason is, suppose if there is a frank perforation, you know, aspirate, please. So, suppose if there is a frank perforation, I would give protamine, but I haven't encountered yet. The reason I don't practice giving protamine is because when we do this ProGlide, there are micro dissections which happen in the common femoral artery. Suppose you give protamine and one of your colleague or would go ahead and do a compression of the groin, there's small possibility of development of a thrombus at the level of femoral artery puncture. The other thing which I think I might be wrong is if you don't give protamine, probably that 24-hour stroke rate might be less. So what happens is that immediately you finish the procedure, there is a dead space around the valve or there's a small particle which would have embolized. Now you reverse the heparin, it becomes a nidus for thrombus formation. So I just don't reverse it and I wait for the ACT to come down gradually over 8 to 10 hours because I load these patients with antiplatelets post-procedure. I don't load them before. And the only reason I would load them before is if I'm doing a concomitant PCI plus TAVR. What is your practice? And maybe sir can throw some light on this concept, which I was thinking.
Indra, a couple of things. I almost always put the pacemaker from jugular site. There is, Bhupati, I think the contention is that just in case it was a transient conduction disturbances and you are hopeful that they are only the patient is much more comfortable for a patient to have a jugular for two things. Number one, apart from comfort, the stability of a pacemaker wire on jugular site is much, much better. So we always use a jugular site.
So that's also a very good idea. So what we do is we would put it from the femoral, but if patient requires a 24-hour pacemaker, we would shift the pacemaker back to jugular position. But the reason I'm just putting it from the femoral in the cath lab is because it is under my control and that makes me a little more comfortable. Otherwise, you're right. If patient requires a 24-hour pacemaker monitoring, it is a good idea to put it from the jugular. Bhupati, how do you do?
Yeah, Ravinder, here what we follow is if it is a 34, 29, it's definitely neckline.
Yes.
If it is 23, 26, and the patient doesn't have normal electrocardiogram, then we go with groin. If there is a QRS prolongation or first degree AV block from the beginning, irrespective of the valve size, we go with neckline.
So, sir and Bhupati, if both of you agree, I'm going to ask my cardiac anesthetist to talk about our conscious sedation protocol because a lot of people would be interested. What we have done is we have done a conscious sedation protocol for kind of an Indian practice because in India, not many centers will be doing high volume TAVR. Here, high volume is one per month or maybe two per month. So, we have devised kind of a safe conscious sedation protocol. And I'm going to ask our anesthetist just to speak a little bit about the protocol. And you have the mic with you?
Yeah.
Prashant? Okay. Can you hear Prashant?
Am I audible?
So, Prashant, because a lot of anesthetists are scared. So, hello. Can you hear Prashant?
Am I audible?
Yeah, you are audible, sir.
Go ahead, Prashant.
Okay, am I audible to you?
Yes, you are audible. Tell us.
Basically, what we do, we just do a PAC with the patient. Am I audible, sir?
Yeah.
So basically, we do a PAC of the patient just before the night of the TAVR procedure. We keep the patient NBM overnight. And after keeping the patient NBM overnight, we apply a Prilox in the early morning. Prilox is a combination of a prilocaine cream. And we apply the cream over the groin mainly because the TAVR will be happening over that part only. And after applying this cream, we take the patient in our OR or in our procedure room after 1 hour. And in OR, we give the premedication in the form of an MCT and pentosid to the patient. Then we give small aliquots of the fentanyl and midazolam to the patient. And then we maintain the patient on Dexmed infusion. simultaneously we will monitor the BIS. That is a level of consciousness of the patient, and we maintain the BIS level around 60 to 80 of that patient. And for oxygenation, we can use nasal prongs, O2 mask, or high flow oxygen, nasal flow cannula, or you can use BiPAP also, according to the patient need. If the patient is a OSA patient, you cannot give sedation too much. So in that patient, we have used a BiPAP mask also for the patient. And during the procedure, if the pressure goes down, we can give boluses of phenylephrine also over there.
So that was very important. And then we also use nasal CPAP.
And according to the patient need, if we are going to give a Medtronic valve, so there is a high incidence of a blockage over there. So for those patients, we put two center lines.
Yes.
One will be triple lumen and second will be a 6-French sheath. And from 6-French sheath, we can, if we need it, in post-op, we need a pacing, we can guide the pacemaker from there only.
Okay, so that was what we use is, we use the Dexmed infusion, but especially one thing which I want to highlight, the use of a Prilox, it's EMLA, eutectic mixture of local anesthetic. It's like a jelly. So you apply that on both the wrists, both the necks and both the groins. And what we have seen is patient does not feel any pain. And then we give a mixture of 50-50% of bupivacaine and lignocaine. So I think one of important concern which comes to the operator's mind, that patient will move a lot during conscious sedation. So the BIS monitor helps. You want to keep that patient sedated, but not disoriented. So that was an important. So let me go back to let's show the aortogram. So we'll start with the procedure now. Gupti, you want to comment on the aortogram?
Yeah, aorta looks mildly dilated. I mean, moderately calcified valve.
So which catheter will you use to attempt to cross this valve?
Ravindra, what was
it? It's not very hugely dilated root, Ravindra.
31. 31. No. We already showed that on CT scan. The dimension is
2.8.
Yeah, 31 millimeter. 28.
I mean, it's only choice. If I always go with AR2, if it doesn't work, I go with the AL1.
That's Sinai. We work together. Yeah. Me and Rupati.
You know, if I'm not going to do, you know what happens.
Yeah, you'll be. Rupati, you know that. So, but what I have done is I've selected an AL1 catheter in this patient is because, you know, I felt that orifice is very eccentric. Sir, you have any thing to comment on what catheter would you choose to cross the cell?
I generally prefer to do that. I go in a two planner view.
Uh-huh.
Make a small injection from the pigtail catheter that gives me a transmission. Then I come to know where the jet is into the aortic root.
Yeah, so this is very important. Let me show you where the jet is. So if you see that wire which will move, this is the wire which is in the in the way of the jet. So that tells you that is where the jet, and the wire which I'm using is a straight tip thermo and 038 stiff wire, because that's how. Bhupati, which wire would you use?
Yeah, exactly. Same, Ravinder.
If you try to use another wire, you know what happens to you. sir, what do you use, sir?
Ravinder, this is soft wire. The thermo wire is soft and it's moving too much. Then I Teflon wire, straight Teflon wire. 0.5 straight wire.
Mag up, please.
With
Bhupati,
I always start with the
Aruba.
Okay, sir.
There we go.
Yeah, crossing a bicuspid is relatively challenging as compared to a tricuspid valve.
Yeah.
And crossing a bioprosthetic valve is
same length normal valve.
So next bioprosthetic valve is relatively much more challenging.
It is. I have had a case where I had to do a septal puncture and snare the wire and then do the TAVI. So we have an AL1 catheter across. Oh. Next you put a normal exchange length soft wire into the LV. Now come back to the RAO position so that we can see the apex. Okay, go ahead. Make sure wire doesn't come out. Push your wire, Prashant. Okay, can you clear those wires from the field? Okay, pigtail, please. Next is you put a pigtail catheter. No, the wires on the screen, you know, the defib wire and all those wires. Okay. So now we'll put a 6-French pigtail into the LV. Confida wire is ready.
Ravinder, some of the audiences have asked few questions like, what is the experience on pacing the LV with the ConfidaWire itself instead of putting it separate pacemaker?
So I showed that in a live case in India Live, which I did, where I paced from the ConfidaWire in the LV. You can do it. And especially with a self-expanding valve, you can do all the way, all the more, because, you know, even if it loses some capture, it's okay in a self-expanding valve. But what actually happens is that, you know, what I realized is putting a 6 French venous sheath is not harming me or not even harming my patient also. And I've done both ways, but I'm more comfortable in putting a pacemaker. What do you think about it, Bhupati?
We tried once here. We are not comfortable. We feel that's not good for us.
Yeah, same thing. Sir, what do you feel about that thing?
It's the same way. And then remember one thing. But at the end of the procedure, you suddenly find that there is a rhythm disturbance.
Yes. And then you are confused.
Just putting a venous puncture and the worst scenario, if you want, you can keep it in the right atrium hanging there if you are worried about perforation. And
can you do an echo for us?
I don't think the idea is not appealing me that you should pace from peripheral.
Can you show the echo, please? Can you show the Hemant, you have recorded echoes, huh? Yeah. Just play the echo pictures. Echo videos, you can start playing. Yeah. Show the echo, show the LV hypertrophy, and also show the valve. Can I have the ConfidaWire, please?
Yes.
Because we haven't shown the echo yet. So we'll go ahead and show you the echo. Show the gradients. So you see the mean gradient is 57. Can you see the echo gradient?
Yeah.
Yeah, make it stable. The mean gradient is 57. The maximum gradient is 98. The velocity is 4.8. And go to the next one. So we're going to go ahead and put a wire there inside a pigtail. So make sure the wire is always put in the LV inside the pigtail catheter. And the other thing you want to look at is, because in these elderly patients, females who have small LV cavity, make sure your wire stays there. Small LV cavity, you make sure the wire doesn't go behind. So can you show the wire on the echo? Yeah, just see the wire on the echo also. So you see how the wire is touching the lateral wall. Hemant, can you open the valve also and just put some color?
Yeah.
Can you see? And yeah. Okay. Okay, so let's mag down. Can you see the valve there? You see the heavily calcified valve. Put a continuous wave there. Okay. So the important thing which I look on echo is sometimes a septal bulge, because in CT scan, the septal bulge is not well appreciated. And that is because the CT scan is being evaluated during a systolic frame. So it can be there, but the way to confirm is you always do an echo so that you can also look at the physiology of the LV outflow track. Is there any dynamic LVOT obstruction which is present or not? So next is we'll do a valve check. We missed once. Yes, go ahead.
We are moving towards that Boston Scientific Safari extra small wire.
Exactly. We don't have that here, but I was about to point out that extra small wire is good for small LV cavity.
All this LV, small LV, thick LVH.
Yes. Yes. So we're going to do it.
We ensure that we use that Safari small for an extra small wire to patients who have received prior radiotherapy, chemotherapy, or on steroids.
Agreed. So we'll do a valve check now. So let me make it a little more stable so that you can come out of the spine and let us see. You can mag up. Can you rotate, Prashant? Rotate slowly. Rotate the whole device slowly. Slowly.
Wow. Na light na coach. Bina light. Or patient rotate
Okay. Oh, do one thing. Hold this wire so the wire doesn't come out.
Just for the idea of the audience.
I'm going to do it again.
The evolution of Medtronic valve all started with the core valve, which is not a repositionable recapturable valve, followed by Evolut R, which is a repositionable and recapturable valve, followed by Evolut Pro. In addition to Evolut R characteristic with a self-expanding Poseidon valve, which can be repositionable. Yeah. Evolut Pro has got an outer skirt. The length of outer skirt varies depending on each valve. It is 13, 13, 13 and 14 from 23 to 34 respectively. Now we are using Evolut Pro Plus in United States. The Evolut Pro Plus is basically the same like an Evolut Pro, but it has been crimped to a smaller size. Ravinder is going to possibly going to use a go with inline. Am I right, Ravinder?
Yes, yes. So we're going to put a 14 French sheath first. We'll do a pre-dilatation with a 20 mm balloon. And then we'll go with an inline sheath. Because if you have to put a sheath, it will be an 18 French sheath. A 20 French sheath for a pro.
20 French sheath for pro. For
wire.
Pro
just for the wire. Wire tip. That's. So now I have I'm putting a 14 French sheath. And then what I do is you always focus on the wire in the LV. So make sure wire stays there. Because that is the most important thing. And then once your sheath enters the skin, you look down. Show us down. Show us down. Okay, this is important. So you do just see how the sheath goes. Now show the wire in the LV. Because I never want to lose focus of the wire. If wire comes out, it's okay. I'll put it back in. But if the wire does something to the myocardium, it will be a challenge for me. So now keep the wire in place. The dilator comes out. Okay. Prepare the balloon, please. So, before you do a pre-dilatation, 20 balloons. Yeah, yes, sir. Hold the wire.
Line in size. About using Lundquist wire. At the same time, it is not pre-shaped. When the LV cavity is small, the choice should be either Safari or Confida.
Yes. But sometimes what has happened is sometimes we have come across cavities which are very small, and because Safari is not available in India, I would go ahead and shape our Emplas extra stiff or super stiff in a very small curve, making sure that the stiff wire is on inside the curve. So,
Ravindra, between Emplas extra stiff and Emplas super stiff, stiff comes with the preformed curve. Super stiff has no curve.
Yes, super stiff has no curve. But the wire which you have to use is a 1 centimeter floppy tip. Because you don't want to use a 3 centimeter floppy tip. A 3 centimeter floppy tip will not give you enough support in the LV. Bhupati, anything you want to comment on this?
Exactly, Ravinder. In 2013, we have been using 1 centimeter Amplat super stiff, the blue color, purple color wire. Over from 2014 onwards, it's only Confida. During last 7 to 8 months, we complete almost 80% it is Safari.
Yes.
With Safari, so, the chance to have a LV perforation is very, very less, especially in this high-risk patients.
Go ahead, put the balloon, please.
Something about Safari Express. What is that? We don't
know about. Yeah, it's not available in India.
There are 3 forms of Safari, sir. Large, small, and extra small. The loop varies.
Yes, the diameter of the loop. So we are taking a 20 millimeter. Would you use an 18 or a 20 balloon, Bhupati or sir? Anybody would like to comment here?
I usually go with the minimal diameter of the annulus, Ravinder. It's only choice. It doesn't. Yeah. I mean, I usually avoid going more than the minimal dilatation, minimal diameter of the annulus.
Would you go directly in this patient without doing pre-dilatation? Anybody?
No.
Okay, go ahead. Pace at 180, please.
Yep. Especially in C-Bird 0, it's strongly recommended to go with the balloon aortic valvuloplasty.
Yeah. Go ahead. Place at 180. Okay. Go up. Go up. Prashant. Go up. Inflate. Inflate. Okay. Deflate. Stop pacing.
Pacing stopped.
And then you deflate and take out your balloon. Okay. Go ahead. Remove the balloon, please.
What balloon was this?
This is a 20 millimeter Z-Med balloon.
Why Z-Med? Why not Tyshek?
Tyshek is mainly for pediatric interventions, non-calcified vessels, which are very soft leaflets, no calcium. Tyshek will not work here. It will just burst or it will recoil. What do you think, Bhupati?
Tyshek is a kind of a semi-compliant, sir, while Z-Med is a kind of towards non-compliant. But if you want to really crack open it, go for a true balloon. or Atlas. Yeah.
So True is not available in India. What we have is an Atlas Gold.
Okay.
So Tyshak, sir, I don't think Tyshak will work in this patient.
Because Z-Mac made very fast, very fast.
So you see, even with pre-dilatation, we already have a left bundle branch block in this patient. So we'll go ahead and put the TAVR valve. So the 14 French sheath comes out. Now we'll go with the inline sheath. Bhupati, do you want to guide us about how to orient the valve so that the future coronary access is easier?
Go to that. Can you show me the fluid port, Ravindra, in the valve?
Yes, yes. So focus on the fluid port. So you see the flush port there at the back end stays up when we go inside the...
I don't see the flush port, yeah.
Okay, can you see the flush port now, Bhupati, here? Show the flush port here.
The blue screen is preventing... Yeah, okay.
Can you see this flush port here? But I want to focus. The back flush port is in the same
back
line as the...
Is in black the same, flush port?
Is in the same line.
To have commercial alignment, Ravindra, Dr. Tang suggests us to keep the black flush port as the 3 o'clock position.
Exactly.
Instead of 12 o'clock position.
So,
Yeah, excellent.
So that's important for the audience to understand, is because one important thing which should be... which we have to keep in our mind is, as we do TAVR in a youngish population, we would call them youngish for TAVR, you need to have a good coronary access in future if required. Go ahead, make sure. So make sure this is at 3 o'clock position.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so show me down now. So what I do, I'm IA down, 48 magnification. I want to see my wire and the valve both going up.
Mag down.
IA down.
Interestingly, Dr. Bhupati, when you go ahead.
Sure.
Head sign will be aligned with the outer curve of the aorta.
Yes, sir. The hat marker should be in the outer curve of the design thoracic aorta.
Okay, mag up now. Show the wire and they give some volume. Give some volume so that the LV is full. So sometimes I prefer to give some volume to these patients so the LV cavity is not small. Make sure the wire doesn't come out. Push the wire, please. Push the wire. That's okay.
Hat marker is good.
Yeah. Bhupati, can you stress on what is a hat marker here in this for the audience?
The hat marker is the kind of hat-like structure seen in the end of the capsule, the radiopaque thing, what you are seeing in the capsule. It has got a hat-like structure.
Okay. Mag up.
Protruding proximally into the LV now.
Okay, Prashant, come back to the diploma. Come caudal.
Yeah, the hat caudal. Marker is properly aligned.
Yes, so now we'll go ahead and remove our parallax from the ring. Come caudal, please. Yeah, more call. Make ring into a straight line. Good. Stop there. Stop. Okay.
So, Raminder, you use coplanar or two cuspal view?
So, for tricuspid valves, I have started using a cuspal overlay in an RAO caudal view, and it has actually helped us putting the valve a little deeper. But for a true bicuspid, I think that does not hold.
It doesn't matter. We can't help. Matter.
Let's go ahead and take one small picture. Inject. Okay. Forward. Okay. Aspirate. Aspirate, please. Okay, forward. So, one is, it's important to keep the valve on the outer curve. So, push your wire a little so that the wire will push the valve on the outer curve. Okay, good. Okay, go ahead and inject. Okay, so we'll connect our hemodynamics. You want to have your blood pressure always on the screen. So, I'll connect the pressure line to the side port of the sheath. Okay, so let's see. What do you think?
Yeah, we can start deploying.
Yeah, exactly. So we're going to start here. Okay. Prashant, go ahead and start rotating. Deploy here. Slowly, very slow, very slow. There's no rush in it. Wait. So you saw how the valve dives in a little, but I think it looks good here. Go ahead. So it's a bicuspid. You can sometimes be as high as possible, but okay, go ahead. But remember,
is that now or not?
Not yet. But yeah, stop here. So this is the place where I would like to pace sometimes. But I'll take a small picture. Ready for injection? Inject. I think it looks good to me.
Yeah, I think it's good.
Yeah, go ahead and pace at 140, please.
Pacing at 140.
Okay, Prashant, go ahead, start opening. Slow. There's no rush. Slow. Okay, go ahead. Open fully. Go ahead. Open till the blood pressure comes back. One more turn. Go. Okay, Floro safe. Stop pacing.
Pacing stopped.
Okay. So let us look at our hemodynamic screen. You see patient is in sinus rhythm, left bundle branch block. Our pressure is okay. Let's take a picture here. Ready for injection?
So, I would recap, Charavinder.
Yeah, so we'll go a little higher in this patient. Otherwise, so what is happening is on one side, we are look 6 millimeter, but on the other side, it is a little deeper. So we'll go ahead and recapture this thing. Okay, go ahead. But you know, if this is a... Go ahead, recap forward.
Yes.
Okay. But if this is a... You know, sometimes if you feel that you'll have to post dilate, okay. Yeah. We'll do a partial recapture.
There are 4 parameters what okay, we
ahead, actually... Go ahead, release now.
When doing this 80% injection, number 1 is the valve position. Number 2 is coronary
go ahead.
Flow.
Go ahead.
3 is AR.
Yeah.
Number 4 is valve deformation.
Okay. Yeah. Fluorosave.
Looks so now, look much better.
Now looks good to us because we are almost 0 millimeter at one side.
Yeah.
But let's take a picture there. Inject. So I think this looks good to me. So what is going to happen is on the other side, if you see, it is a little deeper. But on one side, we are almost 0 millimeter. Okay. So because it's a bicuspid valve, even if you are slightly higher, we should be fine. If you see in this patient, the diastolic pressure is 70. The systolic is 130. So give me an aureocaudal view again. Come to aureocaudal. Yeah. Okay. Remove the parallax. Cranial. Okay. Come caudal now. Caudal. So remove the parallax from the lowermost portion. Come more caudal. Okay. Let's take a picture there. Center. Okay. Ready? Yeah. So I think on one side, you know, if you see, we are slightly above the annular plane. What do you think?
It's a -1.
Yes. So what is your feeling? Go back to the LAO. Remove the parallax. So I think we'll go ahead and capture this page. I think to me sometimes, we'll capture this valve a little.
Zero or +1 should be okay.
Zero. So go ahead and capture.
But Ravindra.
Okay. Yeah. Capture. Okay, let's go ahead and capture above. Okay, capture. Okay, good. So we're going to go in a little deeper on this side now. Okay, let's come back with our pigtail. Let's go. Let's take a picture here. Okay, inject. Okay, go more. So what is happening is because our pigtail is not at the right spot, we are missing the annular plane. Okay. Okay, let's take a picture there. Fill it. Okay, 10 ml. Okay, inject. This is good. So we're going to go ahead and start deploying. Go ahead. Slow, very slow. Go ahead, slow. Yeah, fill that contrast. Go ahead. Yeah, open it up. Yeah, wait. Okay. Okay, inject. Yeah. This looks good to me. On one side, we almost fluoro save. Okay, let's go ahead. Pace slowly, very slow. Very slow. Pace. Go ahead. Pace at 140.
Pacing.
Okay. Slowly. Slow. Wait.
Positive.
Yeah. Let's take a picture. Okay. Inject. Okay, so we've gone a slightly inside. What we'll do is go ahead.
Opening.
Yeah, open. Okay, open till the pressure comes back. Okay, one more turn. Okay, wait. Stop pacing. So I think this looks good to me. What is going to happen is that, because what I'm going to look at here is a sinus rhythm, no heart block, a diastolic pressure is good. At a systolic of 97, I have a diastolic of 55. And if I look at my pigtail positions, so I think it's, let's take one picture, but we'll accept this position because patient is in sinus rhythm. Patient has a diastolic of 60 at a systolic of 107. And show us on echo. Let us look on echo. What you can look at is you can look at the position at the level of AML hinge point. So just for the audience sake, the reason why we, if this was an octogenarian, as I said, I would have taken the first position for sure because your patient was in sinus rhythm. There was no heart block. Show us the echo. But because she's 68 year old, we need to have a good position. So I'm going to show you on echo. So on echo, to me, it looks very good. It is at the AML hinge point, not beyond that. And give some volume, sir. Give some volume. What the reason why we want to give volume is because, you know, these patients, sometimes the LV becomes hypercontractile and the cavity becomes more smaller and you'll start to have residual gradients. Can you see the echo?
Yeah.
What do you think about the depth of the valve on the echo? So we do all transthoracic because it's a conscious sedation valve.
It looks good.
Looks good. Let me show you the color. So no aortic regurgitation. Can you see? Even with the wire in place, there is no significant AR. Sir, do you agree?
Yes.
There's a small whiff which is coming out. But remember, this is a and the depth looks good because you're not even into the LVOT.
Yes.
And now show Hemant. Can you show the gradients also? Because let us see even before without releasing, what gradients do we have? So the pigtail position is not correct for the audience. If they look at the pigtail is way high. Yeah. Put a continuous wave there. Just a small whiff on the AML side. So just put a continuous wave for the gradients. Trace that for us. So mean is 10. So the one more advantage of waiting a little bit is because now the valve annulus, it anchors to the annulus. The patient is hemodynamically stable. Suppose patient is not stable, then you go ahead and do a fast release. But now show us the hemodynamics. And now suppose if I have to do a post dilatation, I have a little bit of depth. But if I was at -1, as I showed in the previous position, and if patient requires a post dilatation, you can't do anything. Okay. Okay, so we'll take one picture and then we'll go ahead and release this thing. We'll show you a picture there. Ready? So I want to put it towards the left side here because I want to see the left coronary flow. Let me try. This is not an angle pigtail, so I might have some trouble, but let's see. Okay, ready for an injection? Okay, go ahead, inject. This looks good to me. We are at 0 now. Yeah. So I think we'll go ahead and release this valve. Everybody agrees?
Yeah.
Okay.
Positive pressure, I think, no?
Yes. So we'll have to maintain a positive pressure. We'll have to pull our wire and we'll have to pace this valve. Okay. So I think for a bicuspid, this is a good position. The coronary is still flowing. Let's look at the coronary flow. I think the coronary flow is good. Okay, so
slightly falling towards it.
Yes, I see that calcified leaflet. You see how it has entered into the sinus? Okay. So if both of you agree, we'll go ahead and release this valve.
Yeah, I think
okay. Okay. So let's do you want to pace this patient while releasing because blood pressure is 180?
Yes, Ravinder, I would say pay mean pressure of 70 because we are relatively on the higher up.
Little bit higher, yes.
And after releasing, I would again say don't stop the pacing, pace at 80.
I would. Exactly. So I do that in a patient who has concentric LVH and septal hypertrophy. I would release by pacing at 180 and then I would continue pacing at 120 or 100 for a few more seconds. It's just, you know, makes me comfortable. I just feel that it's going to anchor a little. It gets time to get anchored and there is no no, what do you call as extra beats, which would do a, so let's space it, which would do a forceful contraction. Let us space it. I'm going to maintain a forward pressure. Let us space at 140, please. Okay. Do a slow release, Prashant. Okay. Slow. Yeah, go ahead. Yeah, go ahead. Very slow. Turn by turn. Okay. Slow. Okay. Go ahead. Go ahead. Keep turning. Keep turning. Keep turning. Okay. Okay. Fluoro save. Fluoro save. So it is still anchored there. I'm going to push forward a little. Okay, yes. That's released. So we're going to pull our nose cone. It's very important. How do you pull the nose cone? So you pull the wire, centralize it. Okay, continue pacing. Don't worry about it. Okay, this comes out. Prepare the 14 French feet again. Okay. So we're going to capture the push. So we're going to do a capture here. Do a partial capture. Do a counterclock turn. Okay, go ahead and... push the wire. Push the wire. Careful with the wire. Okay. Okay. Prepare the 14 French sheath.
Ready.
Okay. Stop pacing now.
Wait, sir. Wait. Wait.
Okay. Okay. So show the hemodynamics. You see sinus rhythm, left bundle branch block, a systolic of 60. Sorry, diastolic of 60, a systolic of 120. I don't think there is any significant AR, which I'm going to do a post-dilatation here. But let us look at the echo now. Just focus on the echo. Okay, give us a pigtail, please.
Ravinder, can you show the fluoroscopy? Let us have a look at the C-tab.
Yeah, I've already removed. Yeah, I'm going to show you. So let us look at the echo, and so that you all are comfortable about the depth. So okay. let's see the echo here. So you see how the fluoro was a little bit fooling us, and that was because of a bicuspid anatomy. So you see the valve frame, which is well into the LV outflow tract. Can you see that?
Yeah.
And the mean gradient is, Hemant, can you calculate the mean gradient for us? Mean gradient is 4.52. Okay, Hemant. Now let us look at the hemodynamics. Okay. Do a parasternal long axis. What do you think about the hemodynamics? 140 by 63, 66. Sir.
Perfect.
Big gradient, Ravindra. I didn't understand.
Mean is, I'm going to put the catheter now. I'll show you, sir. So you see, we are a little bit into the LVOT. We are just at, I think it's 0 and 1 position. Even if we have to post dilate, it's a good spot. But I really don't want to post dilate is because 26 millimeter valve is almost around 22% oversized. Though the balloon which I'm planning is at 22, but the average diameter was 20.2. Put some color, Hemant. What do you think about this plaque's parasternal long axis view and the echo? So I think that's good, Hemant. Thank you very much. So what I'll do, we'll evaluate the AR by... Hemant, can you remove your finger? We'll evaluate the AR by three things. One is we'll calculate an AR index. Second is we have already done is echo. And then we'll also show you an aortogram. So you put the pigtail, the wire comes out. Give me that pressure line. So for the audience, please don't go because the most important part is Dr. Bhupati's lecture. Can you have the same scale?
Simultaneous
tracings? Zero. Zero is wrong. So you see our zero is wrong on one of the pressure lines. So sometimes that happens is when you do a live case, all of a sudden you'll not have an invasive hemodynamic gradient. But I don't panic about it too much is because we have already proved aortic stenosis before we take the patient on table. Can we have the pressures, please? No, it's not yet zero. But look at the diastolic, these 65.
Zero
nahi ho rakha hai na? Zero karo na? Scale do. Kya ho rakha hai? Mm-hmm. Okay, so you want me to open this? You can any comments from Bhupati or sir, any comments?
I think Ravindra.
Yes, sir.
Bhupati was making a mention about CTAB.
Yes. Let us talk about CTAB and its guidance to the coronary access. Bhupati,
can you show the LAO, Ravindra? Plain LAO?
Plain LAO. Go to plain LAO. So for the audience, the CTAB view is important. We are looking
more LAO. More LAO. I'm
going to go. Remove the caudal. And if you have a valve in your hand, you will be able to understand it better. That what we are talking about.
Good enough.
Mag up. I'm going to show you Bhupati once. Mag up. Okay. Keep playing this.
So yes. The CTAB, this is the point of, this is one of the commercial post of the valve. Okay, that's from the bottom of the valve up to 26 millimeter, the commercial post extends. So we all know that left main is going to originate from the left side of the valve in this anatomical position. If you look at, this patient has not received a valve, you know where exactly the left main is going to originate. In general, whatever we are describing holds true for a tricuspid, tri-leaflet anatomy, not for a kind of bicuspid valve, but we can extrapolate it. This LAO picture clearly shows that we are not sitting on the left main ostium. Left main ostium is on the left side of the valve clearly. So we should be able to engage it relatively easily in this patient.
Yes. So for more clarification, maybe Bhupati, if you have a small diagram when you are presenting your things,
I will be able to show you, Ravindra.
So because that commercial tab which you are talking about will be very important. You know, TAVI is as TAVI is moving.
Can you slightly decrease the LAO, Ravindra?
I will. Flush, please, flush. So see, that is why I don't do these hemodynamics. They trouble us a lot sometimes because it's flushing. Okay, go ahead. So go. How much LAO you want, Bhupati?
Slightly decrease. In general, we go with the LAO what we initially made. Maybe we go with the coplanar.
Okay. Okay, go to the LAO 28. 20. LAO 28, please. 28, please. Caudal one. Shall you are going cranial. Okay.
You can see two taps there on the top of the valve. One is facing towards you. The other one is away from you. The one that faces towards you is called a C-tap. It has got a C-shaped structure hole on it. If this C-tab is going to be on the inner curvature of the aorta, for example, this is the inner curvature of the aorta, at least two struts, then we are 70 to 80% of the time, the commissures are properly aligned.
Can you focus
proper
on
positioning of C-tab, still we can have commissural malalignment.
Yeah. So what I'll do, I'll just try to, can you see my fingers?
Yeah.
So this is how the valve leaflets are hanged. So what Bhupati is trying to say, you orient the valve in such a way that this kind of a, you know, curtain kind of thing does not come in front of left main. What you want is that U shape comes in front of the left main, which will allow easy access. I hope that makes it more. Can we have the hemodynamics? Can you see the hemodynamics now? So we have an AR. Let's calculate the AR index. So 16. Diastolic is around 56, so that is 40 divided by systolic is 130.
136.
Bhupati, 40 by 130 into 100.
31.
I'm trying to take
33%. So I think that's acceptable. We'll take an autogram now. Let's take an autogram.
Ravindra, can you see the valve on my hand?
Your hands are not coming. You'll have to share your screen.
No. My video should be seen, no?
No, your video is... Can somebody play Dr. Bhupati's video? Aspirate?
Yo, man.
Okay, Bhupati. Wait a minute. We'll show that in aspirate. Okay. Ready for an aortogram? Center? 10 foot. Okay, ready? Okay, inject.
Perfect.
So I think we have a good depth. We have a sinus rhythm. We have a left bundle branch block. We have an AR index of almost 33. We have trivial AR on Echo, and because it's a pro, I think the outer skirt, this AR will go away in next maybe 6 months. And it's a young patient, 68-year-old patient. I would not prefer to post dilate because you see the left leaflet is already reaching the sinus. Sometimes even with the post dilatation, what actually happens is the calcium on the leaflet can break and go into the left main and LAD. And that's also one of the reasons why you can have a left main or LAD occlusion despite leaflets being away from the left main. So, A.B. Mehta, sir, if you agree, I'm going to do a pullback. I'll pull out everything.
Yeah.
And we'll show you one angioseal and one proglide. Give me a wire, please.